Chapter 27, Final Obsequies of General Sherman, Grand Procession of Troops and Civic Bodies. On February 21st, St. Louis was bade an impressive farewell to the soldier whose military genius was excelled by none and equaled by few. For the first time in several days, the sun shone out gloriously, but its rays fell upon a city draped in mourning. The hearts of the people were saddened, and with one accord all manner of men abandoned their earthly pursuits and assembled along the line of the funeral procession to do homage to the honored dead. As early as 6:30 in the morning, the Union Depot was thronged with people awaiting the arrival of the Sherman funeral train. As the morning advanced, the crowd became larger, and each train as it entered the depot deposited load after load of human freight, which added to the throng until the depot became almost impassable. When the hands of the big clock pointed to 8:20, a squad of police marched to the depot, and soon the immense crowd was under control. For miles, the streets were lined with solid walls of people, standing at least a dozen deep, and the evidences of affection in which his fellow townsmen held General Sherman were abundant on all sides. The city was draped in mourning. Evidences of individual sorrow were also abundant, and badges of ribbon and crepe fluttered with every coat lapel. The grief of those in the procession was not quite alone genuine, but apparent to everyone. His comrades of Ransom Post marched in Hollow Square about the caisson. The historic 13th. Following the caisson were the handful of survivors of the old 13th Infantry, a small and grief-stricken body of men, following their old leader over a road which they too must travel at no very far distant day. There were, besides, thousands of veterans of the war, members of the Grand Army of the Republic, old and grizzled comrades in arms of the dead general. Slowly they walked, and only too plainly was it written that the ravages of time were fast depleting the ranks of the preservers of the Union. Yet none of them were so feeble that they would admit, even to themselves, that they were taxing their strength in following Sherman to Calvary, even as they had followed him to Savannah. Arrival of the funeral train. The funeral train arrived at just 8:30. As it crossed the bridge, a salute from a nearby battery announced its approach. Emerging from the tunnel, it was compelled to proceed slowly while the police cleared the tracks of people. On the depot platform was Governor Francis and his staff, and the members of the General Reception Committee, headed by James C. Yeatman and Henry Pitchcock. After an exchange of greetings, the governor and representatives of the General Committee and Ransom Post, GAR, were introduced to the members of the cabinet and Lieutenants Fitch and Thackeray. Meantime, outside, the military companies were moved into position. The caisson on which the body was to be borne from the train to its resting place was standing on Poplar Street, at the entrance of the carriageway. It was from Battery E, 1st Artillery, and was under Lieutenant Wilson, with Sergeant Cannon in immediate charge. It was drawn by 6 bay horses. The riders were the men who worked the Hotchkiss gun at the Battle of Wounded Knee Creek during the recent Indian War. They belonged to the 7th Cavalry, known as the Fighting 7th. Their names were Privates Mallory, Ryan, and Kraus. The body bearers were 8 sergeants. 4 of them, Sergeants Connolly, Lang, Hennessy, and Siegber, were from the 7th Cavalry. The other 4, Sergeants Hunneman, LeVay, French, and Donahue, were from Battery E, 1st Artillery. The Riderless Horse. In front of the caisson on Poplar Street was the 12th Infantry from Fort Leavenworth, under command of Colonel Townsend, drawn up in line facing the depot. On the opposite side of the street were the members of Ransom Post who were to act as guard of honor. The horse that was to be led behind the caisson, equipped with the dead general's saddle, bridle, boots, and spurs, stood next to the caisson. He was a black horse belonging to Troop D, 7th Cavalry of Fort Riley, Kansas, and was brought from there especially for this purpose. It was led by Sergeant George H. Rathguber. The hearse on this occasion was not covered with a black cloth, as was done in the general parade in New York. Removal of the body from the train. At 10:15, an open barouche drove into the carriageway. All of the floral pieces brought from New York and those received during the trip were put in this carriage to be conveyed to the cemetery. General Merritt and his staff arrived at the depot at 10:30. At this hour, the adjacent streets of 12th Street Bridge were fairly black with people. The police had all they could do to keep room enough for the procession to move in. Immediately after the arrival of General Merritt and staff, preparations were made to remove the body from the car where it had rested during its long journey. The 8 body bearers took up positions at the car door, 4 on each side. Directly behind them, 6 on a side, stood the honorary pallbearers. They were Military Major General John Pope, Brevet Major General Amos Beckwith, Brevet Major A.J. Smith, Brevet Major General John W. Turner, Brevet Major General Willard Warner, Brevet Brigadier General John W. Barriger, Commander Charles S. Cotton, USN, Citizens, Judge Samuel Treat, Colonel George E. Layton, Colonel Charles S. Parsons, Byron Sherman, Esquire, Daniel B. Harrison, Isaac Sturgeon, and Thomas E. Tutt. A silent throng. Ranged in line on each side of the carriage entrance were the military and public officials who had accompanied the remains from New York, General Merritt and staff, and Governor Francis and staff. 3 comrades of Ransom Post entered the funeral car and assisted the 6 sergeants in charge to lift the casket out through the car door to the shoulders of the waiting pallbearers. As the end of the flag-covered oaken box was passed through the door, every head was uncovered and silence reigned supreme. Slowly and carefully, the precious burden was taken from the car and placed on the shoulders of the stalwart sergeants. As they started with slow step out through the carriageway to the waiting caisson, the 12th Infantry presented arms, flags were dipped, and the regimental band played Pleyel's well-known hymn. Many, many hearts were touched by the sight, and veterans and comrades of the dead soldier could be seen crying on all sides. General Howard and Slocum were so overcome they could not speak for several minutes. The casket was placed lengthwise on the caisson and strapped in place. On it were placed the hat and sword of him who lay inside. The delivery of the remains to the St. Louis bodyguard relieved the 6 sergeants who had accompanied it from New York of all further care. The procession. When the fastening of the casket was finished, Colonel L. Townsend gave the order to march, and the 12th Infantry wheeled into line and marched up 11th Street to the corner of Clark Street. Here they halted. The open carriage with the floral pieces followed directly behind. Then the order was given by Lieutenant Wilson, and the caisson, with its sacred burden, moved slowly up 11th Street to a place next to the carriage containing the flowers. On each side of the caisson walked the 4 military body bearers. Directly the caisson started, the 400 members of Ransom Post, who had made up the honor guard, marched up in 2 columns, one going to one side and the other on the opposite side of the caisson. The saddle horse bearing the riding equipments of the general was led just behind the caisson and between the columns of Ransom Post. Meanwhile, the immediate members and relatives of the Sherman family had filled coaches and were now driven into a place in the procession next to the guard of honor. Behind the family were carriages in which were the people who had come from New York to attend the funeral. In the first coach were Secretary and Mrs. Noble, Judge Hugh, and Major Randolph. In the second, Secretary Rusk, Assistant Secretary Grant, Charles A. Greeley, Captain Kingsbury. The third carriage contained ex-President Hayes, General Schofield, General Stannard, and Lieutenant Anderson. The fourth, General Howard, Slocum, and Broadhead, and Lieutenant Howard. The fifth, General Alger, James E. Yeatman, Colonel McCreary, and General James D. Moore. When these carriages had taken their proper places in the line, General Merritt with his staff galloped to the head of the procession, which was at the corner of Clark Avenue and 11th Street. At just 10 minutes after 11, all division commanders having reported everything ready, General Merritt gave the order to march. Great popular demonstration. The funeral column was made up of 6 divisions, composed of the regular military escort as provided by Army regulations, and Grand Army posts, Loyal Legion, Sons of Veterans, Civic Societies, State Militia of Missouri and Ohio, and legislatures of Missouri, Illinois, and Kansas, governors of states and staffs, unorganized bodies, and citizens in carriages and on foot. The route of the procession from the depot to Calvary Cemetery, a distance of nearly 8 miles, was through some of the principal streets and avenues. After starting from the junction of 11th Street and Clark Avenue, the cortege moved up 11th Street to Market, through Market to 12th, and through 12th to Pine Street. The route was through the business section. The stores were closed, but the windows of nearly all the big blocks were filled with spectators, and the sidewalks were filled with crowding, surging masses of humanity. While there was no disorder, in the full sense of the word, in the streets mentioned, the jam of people coming in from the various intersecting streets when the procession started was something terrific. Strong men and weak women were swept along by this human tidal wave until they were brought to a standstill by the crowds that already had possession of every inch of available standing room. The march to the cemetery from the depot was through some of the principal streets of the city. The route laid out was through 11th, Market, 12th, and Pine and Grand Avenue, thence out Florissant Avenue to Calvary Cemetery. The entrance to the cemetery was by the rear gate. The larger part of the military remained outside of the cemetery. The scene at the cemetery. When the caisson entered the gates of the cemetery, most of the troops remained outside of the cemetery. On account of the large number of carriages occupied by Grand Army men, members of the Loyal Legion and the sons of veterans who were unable to endure the fatigue of the entire march of nearly 8 miles, and for whom carriages were provided at the corner of Grand and Eastern Avenues, the road from the entrance to the cemetery to the grave was soon blocked, and many of those who occupied carriages and near the end of the procession were obliged to leave them some distance from the gate and walk to the grave. This caused some delay, and it was not until 2:30 that all who had been assigned places took their positions about the open grave, which was lined inside with flags. A short distance to the south was the brave 13th, to the east members of the GAR, and directly around it to the north were grouped Senator Sherman and Mrs. Sherman, P.T. Sherman, Colonel Hoyt Sherman, Lieutenants Thackera and Fitch and their wives, Judge and Mrs. P.B. Ewing, General and Mrs. Thomas Ewing, General and Mrs. Nelson A. Miles, Secretary and Mrs. Noble, Secretary and Mrs. Rusk, Assistant Secretary Grant, Ex-President Hayes, General Schofield, General Howard, General Slocum, and others. After all had taken their positions, the 8 sergeants, acting as body bearers, lifted the casket from the caisson and bore it reverentially to the grave, when all that was mortal of General Sherman was lowered to its last resting place. The casket was draped with flags and was bare of any floral tributes. The services at the grave. The services were of the simplest character and were conducted by Reverend Thomas Ewing Sherman, all assembled at the grave standing with uncovered heads. As the casket was being lowered, the regimental band played Pleyel's hymn. Father Sherman read the Catholic service, one of the selections being, "I am the resurrection and the life," offered a fervent prayer, and the services were at an end. As the services progressed, many about the grave were visibly affected, and when the flags surrounding the casket were removed, the sounds of low sobbing were heard. At 3:00, the closing of the grave took place, and the buglers of the 7th Cavalry sounded taps, lights out. Salutes were fired by the 13th Infantry, followed by 3 salvos of artillery, which was stationed some distance to the east. Wreaths and branches of evergreens were then placed upon the grave by loving hands. The funeral party and troops returned to the station, and the many thousands of citizens dispersed to their homes. Thus was laid to rest by the side of his wife and 2 sons, one of whom was his soldier boy, General William Tecumseh Sherman. Description by an eyewitness. The following graphic recital of the events attending the last obsequies is from the pen of an eyewitness of the wonderful spectacle. The scene at the St. Louis Union Depot as early as 6:00 was one of great animation, and by the time the funeral train arrived, the crowd rivaled in numbers the largest ever seen in this city. Every few minutes, from 6:40 a.m. to 10:00, a train would roll in bearing a company or a regiment of militia under arms and in full uniform, besides numerous civilians and state dignitaries from other states. Committees were promptly on hand to meet and escort them to their respective places, and notwithstanding the push and jam of the crowd, there was but little confusion in readily carrying out the program that had been previously arranged. With the marching and countermarching of the incoming troops, with their glistening bayonets, the scene just before the arrival of the funeral train vividly called to mind the excitement attending upon the movements of an army during the war. It was early announced that the funeral train, which was expected at 7:30, would not arrive until 8:25, so there was no anxious waiting upon the part of the committees appointed to meet it. A few minutes after 8:00, Colonel Broadhead, chairman of the reception committee, and a number of the members of his committee assembled in the ladies' waiting room of the depot and were soon joined by Governor Francis and several other prominent gentlemen. They proceeded to a position just outside the main entrance, where they were joined by General Merritt. Dense crowd. Promptly at 8:30, the funeral train was sighted slowly approaching around the curve at the east end of the yards. Its approach was announced by a salute. The crowd that now lined both sides of the track to a depth of several feet became anxious to catch a view of the train, and were with great difficulty pressed back by the police, who were stationed every few feet along the track. The engine drawing the train was number 8 of the Bridge and Tunnel Company. It was heavily draped in black, and on the headlight was placed an engraving of the dead general surrounded by a band of black, while over the engine was fastened a United States flag draped with crepe. Slowly, with muffled bell, the engine pulled past the main entrance, revealing one after another the 8 heavily and tastefully draped coaches composing the funeral train, till the locomotive reached the 12th Street Bridge. Impressive scene. Immediately following the engine was the funeral car, with the doors of either side pushed back, revealing the interior. The floor was covered with a handsome carpet, and in the center was a catafalque on which rested the black walnut casket covered with a silk flag, while on top of it lay the dead general's sword and hat. At the head of the casket were a number of beautiful floral emblems, and at the foot, on a stand, were the saddle, bridle, boots, and other riding equipments of the dead hero. The interior of the car was entirely covered with black cloth. On either side of the catafalque stood erect the guard of honor, composed of the following past commanders of Ransom Post, who went on to meet the train at Indianapolis: John B. Harlow, J.G. Butler, Smith P. Gault, and A.G. Peterson. The commercial strife of a great city was arrested for a few hours when the people of St. Louis ranged themselves in line and paid reverence to the remains of William Tecumseh Sherman. Outwardly, this aspect of mourning was preserved throughout the day, save for the activity of the restless ones who, having satisfied their curiosity, set about their business. No one can gainsay the affection and respect felt for General Sherman by the mass of the multitude who forsook their customary vocations. It was shown in the deep and reverential silence maintained while the procession passed, in the eagerness of the many whom a mere military show does not summon from their homes. The spectacle offered by the funeral procession was most impressive and significant. 2 generations of men and women blocked the sidewalks along Pine Street and Grand Avenue for many miles. For the older generation, war had been a horrible reality. For the younger, it was but an historical episode. But young and old were perhaps equally impressed by the solemnity of it all. The murmur of expectation caused by the distant sound of approaching troops was stilled when the first horseman advanced, and silence fell upon the multitude assembled to the west of where the procession had gotten under way. All was in harmony with the occasion. Early in the morning the clouds lowered forbiddingly, and there seemed small hope that the wretched weather of the past week would be broken. But just before 11 o'clock, the hour set for the order to march, the sun absorbed the mist and shone cheerfully enough, and a light breeze bore away the smoke and the lingering fog. The streets had been washed clean by the heavy rains, the air was fresh and bracing. It was excellent marching weather. Bronzed veterans. The sight of trained soldiers is always an inspiring one. In line was a regiment of the regular army, a regiment made up of cavalry, artillery, and infantry, bronzed and weather-beaten men, most of them who formed a dignified and solemn escort to the remains of the old commander. The troops showed service, and when the broken companies of the 7th Cavalry rode by, the spectators were reminded that war is even yet a reality, and that these men had fought at wounded knee. No more melancholy procession than a military funeral finds its way to a cemetery. Neither crape nor coffin was needed to emphasize the mournfulness of that march to the grave. The impression of sorrow was conveyed in the slow steps of the soldiers, in the sad strains of bugles which were molded for inspiring melody, and in the sullen tone of muffled drums. As the escort moved west, there came a sound even more doleful than these. It was the tolling of the bell in the tower of St. John's Catholic Church at 16th and Chestnut Streets. It began before the escort was under way, and clanged a cheerless accompaniment to the slow and monotonous tramp of the troops. Then one of the military bands struck up a funeral march, and people easily affected felt glad that the sun was shining. Tokens of grief. Since the war in which Sherman fought, there has perhaps occurred nowhere in the West so imposing a public ceremony. In the matter of mere numbers, there has been no such body of men in line in St. Louis since the encampment of the Grand Army of the Republic. It was not singular, then, that the railways brought to this city thousands of strangers who, swelling the local population, made sightseers thankful that the route to the cemetery was so long. Otherwise, the pavements and the windows along the line of march would scarcely have accommodated the crowds. They stretched for miles up Pine Street and along Grand Avenue, and the streets at their intersection were blocked with well-filled wagons. Mourning was displayed in many windows, and while the procession was underway, St. Louis and its people showed innumerable tokens of sincere grief. There was something more than this visible in the attitude of the older spectators. They realized that another link in the chain of events between 1861 and 1891 had been broken, that another paragraph was prepared for American history, and they took their way thoughtfully to their homes, never to forget the mournful scenes of the day. Seldom has St. Louis ever made such a display of visible tokens of its sorrow. Perhaps it has never been more universally draped in mourning. Both in the business portions and the residence neighborhoods, there was a general display of funeral hangings. The stately buildings on the downtown streets and the small and unpretentious shops removed from the business center were alike draped. On the public buildings, the somber materials were unsparingly used. Along parts of the route of the funeral pageant, every building was made to testify to the general sadness. In every part of the city, the same mournful scenes were presented. The drapery and other emblems varied in quality, quantity, and perhaps in taste and skill of arrangement, but whether it was the black calico draping of the small shop, or the cashmere serge bombazine, bunting, or broadcloth of the richer houses, it nonetheless testified to the popular esteem in which the city held the dead hero. Flags in graceful folds. Many liberally disposed persons incurred great expense in this work of love and reverence, though they occupied houses in unfrequented streets where their displays were hidden from general view. The materials used in the principal downtown thoroughfares and in the wealthier residence neighborhoods were all costly. The piers of the basement section of the government building were heavily shrouded with black, and the upper stories were hung with the same materials, secured with black rosettes. The city buildings were all elaborately draped with black materials and flags. In the windows everywhere were portraits of Sherman in black frames. Large flags, gracefully arranged in folds or looped up with black bands, were used as drapery on many of the big business buildings and on private dwellings. On others there were many small flags with crepe sashes. A large flag with a heavy black bar extending diagonally across it floated over Washington Avenue near 7th Street. Broad bands of mourning were stretched lengthwise across several buildings on the street, and a large number of the windows were handsomely decorated. Black and white feathers tastefully grouped, and sheaves of wheat and rye with appropriate inscriptions made many of the large windows on the principal streets attractive. The banks, the railroad offices, big wholesale houses, hotels, and other large edifices all bore some mournful tribute to the dead man. It was all done hurriedly, but nonetheless tastily. The wealthy residents on the streets and avenues through which the funeral procession passed had their palatial abodes put in mourning costume by skilled decorators and designers. The work was not elaborate, but it was rich, costly, and in keeping with the homes. Many of these houses were not draped, however, either because of the short time allowed for the work after it was known what route the funeral procession would take, or because of a question of propriety. Myriads who honor the hero. The hotels were all so well filled that many of the latecomers to the city could not obtain rooms, but myriads came for the day only, and the numbers who sought accommodations at the hotels furnished no fair standard by which to estimate the entire number of strangers in the city. By noon, the population had bounded from its ordinary limit at 500,000 to very much nearer 600,000, and citizens and strangers were out early, side by side, seeking the most advantageous point possible from which to view the procession. Hundreds of country relatives and friends found comfortable quarters in the houses of citizens within view of the line of the march, but there were myriads who were less fortunate. Trainload after trainload rolled into the depot from every point of the compass during the first half of the day. The day had scarcely begun when the earliest arrivals were landed, and soon there were in all of the downtown streets little broken, irregular lines of men and women wandering about till time for the pageant to move. In a short time, these processions became denser and broader. A little later, armed and uniformed lines of men gave variety to the scene. Soon they were all over the downtown district. They no longer moved in thread-like lines. The sidewalks were no longer broad enough to hold them. Every house except those along the line of march seemed to give up its occupants to join the strangers in the wild rush hither and thither, jostling and pushing to get in the streets from which the column could be seen, and afterward to get good standing places there. Marshall dirges. Then there was a blare and clash of bands, and the big crowd increased its struggle to get the vantage points. Hundreds of them took to the streetcars and were quickly transported far out along the line. Hundreds of others did not understand the necessity of going early, and as a result the jam was so great in many of the downtown streets that the streetcars were delayed or stopped entirely when the procession was forming. All kinds of vehicles were moving in the direction of Pine Street long before the cortege was to move. Trucks of all kinds, licensed and unlicensed vendor wagons and carts rigged out with rows of wooden benches, light wagons, carriages, coaches, and cabs were called into use to give the anxious people an opportunity to see the uniformed line. But many of them were disappointed. The windows, roofs, and balconies were lined with people before the procession moved, and still others came pushing and crowding, creeping under wagons and crowding behind vicious horses. They rushed pell-mell one way in expectation of finding a vacant place, and then dashed back again when they discovered that there was no such place in sight. Pale-faced, ill-clad women, gaily dressed girls, clerks, working men, and merchants crowded together and conversed while the line moved.